Ladies and gentlemen, I'm delighted to open our plenary session, which has the very ambitious title, Restoring Growth. I'm Jacob Frenkel, and I'm privileged to be with you today. We have an extraordinary, distinguished group of panelists that will be introduced in a moment. And of course, we are operating under the hospitality of our great friend, Governor Kairat Kelembeto, who is also with us here today. This is an optimistic way to start our session, restoring growth. To remind you, last year we were addressing the question about how to deal with the crisis, how to survive the epidemic plague that attacked us. It's still with us, but we are learning to live with it. We are learning to take the best that we can as we move ahead. And the most important thing, the challenge is how to restore growth. Growth, per se, is not an informative concept. We need to have sustainable growth. We need to have inclusive growth. This growth that is breaking frontiers of knowledge, of productivity, of creativity, and much of the side effects of the corona crisis has been forcing us, each in his own way, each one in his own country, to identify what's the best way to adjust. And again, flexibility of the economic system, and I would add flexibility of the mind, helps a lot. People around this table today are all extraordinary achieved leaders in their fields, and their reflections on this subject would be highly important. We have with us Sir Suma Chagrabarti, who is advisor to the presidents of Kazakhstan and Uzbekistan. He is the chair of the Overseas Development Institute, and of course, an extraordinary distinguished public servant and former president of the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development. We have also with us Ms. Georgina Baker, who is advisor to the presidents of Kazakhstan and who is the vice president for Latin America and the Caribbean and Europe and Central Asia, all at the AIFC. We have with us Dr. Liu T, who is executive vice president from the Shanghai Stock Exchange. We have with us Mr. Jihad Azur, who is the director of the Middle East and Central Asia Department at the International Monetary Fund. We have with us also Dr. Shardor Umurzakov, who is the deputy prime minister and the minister of investment and foreign trade from Uzbekistan. And of course, we have with us, I would say, our host, Dr. Kairat Kelembeto, the governor of the AIFC and the chairman of the Agency for Strategic Planning and Reform. They will all address the subject that we were talking about. I already indicated that we have a very different world than what we had before, both economically, politically, conceptually, technologically, in all dimensions. The current pandemic will undoubtedly have lasting effects on us and on the next generation. The world was not the same after 9/11. The world was not the same after the great financial crisis. And the world will not be the same after the current crisis. The important element is how to benefit from the adversity. One could argue that the new virus only accelerated existing trends and changes. Epidemic triggered an almost instantaneous shift to online remote mode, highlighted the immense problem of growing inequality, closed borders in an already deglobalized world. And yet, we know that climate does not recognize borders, health does not recognize borders, knowledge should not recognize borders, and trade is based on the assumption that borders are open. And in this in mind, with this in mind, we will see how the future will unfold. We have been experiencing these trends before 2020. For example, the remote services or identification have been discussed for at least several years. But March 2020 brought these discussions to an abrupt end with the only possible solution switching to the new long-distance model. The same can be said about globalization. Unfortunately, many borders are still closed, and even we today are convening virtually. However, switching to the online mode has allowed us to talk to each other more often. If before we would postpone conversations to face-to-face meetings, after 2020, we rely more on the video conferences as we do today. While, of course, the pandemic took away lives and halted businesses, the way we adapted to the new life is not without a silver lining. We learned to be more efficient and introduced a leapfrogging solutions. Thus, today, we won't be talking only about the challenges and threats posed by the pandemic. Instead, the theme is the opportunities and the prospects into the future. Let us discuss why and how we can ensure growth, having in mind that we can never go back to the previous state. Let us talk about reinventing growth as much as we talk about restoring it. Today, we would like to hear this from our esteemed guests, and let me start immediately with our dear friend, Sersuma Chakrabarti, advisor to the presidents of Kazakhstan and Uzbekistan, chair of the Overseas Development Institute, the United Kingdom. Sersuma, please, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Jacob. I don't know what to say after that grand introduction from you. You've really built me up. Thank you so much for your lovely words. You're a dear friend. I think you actually said something that I wanted to start with, which I think the right title for this is Restoring Sustainable and Inclusive Growth, because that's the growth path we're all interested in. And I would say, from my perspective, through a market-based economy, given my EBRD roots, and I'm sure Georgina at IFC would agree as well very much, that's what we're about. And if I may just take myself, first of all, from a global standpoint, and then come down to Central Asia, I think what I observe of what's happened over the last year and a half through this COVID crisis, really, is some of the things that we were struggling to make enough progress on in terms of the major international commitments of all the countries we work in towards sustainable development goals, we were already in some difficulty. But I think last 18 months, if you look at the green agenda, in many countries, that because the priority, understandably, has been on saving companies, saving jobs, that actually, if anything, there's been less emphasis than I would have liked on sustainable investments, and much more on actually just simply keeping companies afloat. Portfolio protection, actually, for many banks has been the issue. And I think that's been the case for multilateral banks as well as for local banks. And if you look at multilaterals, they actually lent more. But if you look at who they lent to, a hell of a lot went to existing clients and not to new clients. So that's been a big issue. So that's something we need to think about now we're coming out of the pandemic. Secondly, I mean, there were some glimmers of hope on some aspects of what I would call the agenda of equality of opportunity, particularly on gender. I would say so certainly here I will come down to the local level in Kazakhstan. We were making a lot of progress, and also in Uzbekistan, beginnings of progress on gender issues, on dealing with some of the regional inequalities as well that we saw in many emerging markets, same. But with the pandemic, as has happened with most economic crises, there were setbacks. There were setbacks because as companies closed, as they laid off workers, it was very much a last in, first out, I'm afraid. And many women, particularly many of the newer cohorts of workers with less experience, were the ones who were shut out of the market for the last 18 months. And so actually things went bad. And I've been looking at even the Gini coefficient numbers in the two states I serve, and they've certainly worsened in the last couple of years. So it's quite a lot of work to do on equality of opportunity, I think. The third thing that we were talking about, all of us, Jacob, I remember having a conversation with you about this about 2 years ago, was the future of work. And, you know, I guess I thought the future of work might be the future after I retired or something, but I'm afraid the future of work has arrived. At least certain aspects of it have clearly arrived. So the digitization agenda has gone up a quantum leap in the last 18 months. We've all had to learn and do meetings like this in this way. So there's been a huge technological boost in the last 18 months. That has good implications for the way we do business. I think it makes a lot of things much more efficient, reduces costs, speeds up innovation, all of those things. There are also certain downsides, digital exclusion. If you're in a rural area in Uzbekistan or in Kazakhstan, access to digital services, much more difficult. I think it also has aspects of, you know, work for many of our institutions more difficult because they rely on empathy. And empathy is not something you can really build digitally. You need to be face-to-face much more. So there are certain aspects which are enhanced and some challenges, I think, going forward, but we have to live with that. And the fourth angle I would bring out is for those of us particularly pushing for the market economy as the answer to sustainable and inclusive growth has been the rise of the state. The state is back because in a crisis, the state is much needed. And so not just through huge increases in public spending across many emerging markets, advanced countries too, but also it has delayed some of the things we want to do on privatization, PPPs and so on, because it's been much more difficult to get those off the ground in the last year or so. And I think, therefore, to realize what has happened over the last year, the biggest task for emerging markets like Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, and others is not to get locked into a COVID business as usual. In other words, to now realize there are certain things we can do that we've learned and we need to build on. So I think here's a positive. I think the digitization agenda is enormously positive. Yesterday in Nur-Sultan, we had a meeting of the Supreme Presidential Council on reform. And one of the things I'm proudest of that we agreed was a national project on digitization. Kazakhstan actually is one of the leaders in emerging markets in this area, already 29th in the World League table on this area. But it really has ambitions to go much faster on this. And I think it really can do a lot to go much, much faster. Another area where I think suddenly countries realize it's got to make a big move is Uzbekistan on renewable energy. I think what Uzbekistan has been trying to do suddenly to push forward on renewable energy as a response to regaining the ground on green agenda is very, very good as well. So example from each country of how they've actually responded and recognized they must break out of thinking that what happened last year was business as usual. They've got to move on. The other part of this, I think, that's really important, and maybe my last point to make, is the importance of institutions. I mean, okay, I'm a former civil servant, former public servant, so it's in my blood. I believe in good institutions. They're really important. But they're not just important for those of us who work in them. In fact, that's the last thing they should be important for. They should be important for the citizen, but also for business. So it's really important that the state works well to make life of private sector much better, to make businesses flourish better. So thinking about how the state can reinvent itself. And here I think the importance of developing market-based institutions And again, I would give a lot of highlight here to particularly the Astana International Financial Center, AIFC. Khairat is proudly sitting in front of the flag there, I think. I think this is an institution which is really quite important at the moment for Kazakhstan, I hope more for the region broadly. But it is a platform that offers a new world-class and business-friendly operating environment. And it didn't exist until a few years ago. And its own development has been hampered by COVID, of course, like any other institution last year. But I think, again, it's regained its mojo, if I can put it that way. And what we've now got is a new way forward, which we discussed yesterday in our management council. And I see it very much as a market leader for the future, a new generation of market institutions, if you like, being built under it. And I think we need more of those. That's just one example. I think I could give the example in Uzbekistan of what I think is the UFRD, I really like as a potential institution, the Uzbekistan Fund for Reconstruction Development, to build on, to create actually a really more market-based Uzbek economy as well, to attract investment. Again, nascent days, but I think it's worth building on those sort of institutions. So I think the building of institutions is the other thing that actually the pandemic has helped leaders in the two countries I serve think much more about, and about how to create good institutions. So I'll leave it there, Jacob, but I hope that gives you a flavor of where I think the challenges are, but also I think the opportunities for countries like Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, but also other emerging markets too.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Sotuma. You emphasized the importance of institutions, and indeed you come to this with great authority, since under your leadership you demonstrated how the EBRD can be best run as an institution that achieves its objectives. And thank you so much for setting it up. You were speaking about the business environment, the private sector, and I think this is a great lead to our next speaker, Ms. Baker, who will give us that perspective. After all, the IFC is committed to improve the lives of people, and lives have changed. The contributions that the IFC can make to improve the life. Maybe you will have also something to say about the ESG. I'm leaving it to you now, please, Ms. Baker. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Jacob. And a very good morning, good afternoon, and evening to you all. It's a pleasure to join you for this panel from Washington, D.C. I'd like to begin by thanking the organizers for inviting me to this year's Astana Finance Days Forum. I'm very glad to be able to attend this important event for finance and private investment, not only in Kazakhstan, but in the wider region. As you'll know, as we have said, we are now more than a year into the biggest, most severe crisis of our lifetime. And while there has been much success in terms of vaccines, significant risks around future variants of COVID-19 and challenges of access to vaccines, particularly in the developing world, remain. As Central Asia looks to emerge from the pandemic, countries in the region need to decide how to rebuild their economies, reverse setbacks to poverty reduction, and reorient, as Suma said, towards sustainable and inclusive growth. And while there's no one-size-fits-all formula, promoting skills development, particularly the reskilling of the unemployed, investing in new digital technologies, and focusing on climate-related industries are themes that can help with long-term growth. At IFC, we recognize just how vital the private sector is to resilient economy recovery from the pandemic, particularly as governments' balance sheets are increasingly constrained. That is precisely why our response to the COVID-19 revolves around the three R's of relief, restructuring, and recovery, and aims to ensure that the private sector becomes an engine of growth and job creation, improving living standards and helping with technological advancements. For relief, we launched an $8 billion fast-track financing facility last March to provide liquidity to existing clients, helping to keep companies in business and preserve jobs. Much of the funding went to micro, small, and medium enterprises and women entrepreneurs that are at the front line of the COVID-19 impact. I'm pleased to report that at the end of our fiscal year, which ended 2 days ago, June 30, IFC had a record year of investment in the Europe and Central Asia region, with over $4 billion in long-term finance provided. The sub-region that saw the most growth in support across IFC this year was Central Asia, And I'm very glad we've been able to step up in the region at a time of need, while also recognising that a lot more needs to be done. To complement our relief efforts, IFC is also working towards the restructuring of companies whose underlying operations are viable and necessary to support economic growth and sustain employment. We are working closely with our World Bank colleagues to ensure countries have the policies and regulations in place to resolve distressed assets as quickly as possible, such as through faster bankruptcy proceedings and better insolvency rules. As a leader in this space, IFC is well positioned to support the development of a strong distressed asset market through our DARP, Distressed Asset Recovery Programme, and are pleased to be working with the government of Kazakhstan on creating a market for distressed assets in the country. Finally, the third arm of our response strategy is probably the most relevant today, resilient recovery. And our response again here is threefold. We refer to it as GRID, green, resilient, and inclusive development. Firstly, we believe that the recovery should be green. As part of the World Bank Group's new climate action plan, IFC will align 85% of new direct investments with the objectives of the Paris Accord in 2023 and 100% by 2025. Secondly, building back more resiliently is key and requires supporting sectors most adversely impacted by the crisis, such as infrastructure. For example, to help improve Kazakhstan's connectivity and integration, IFC is currently finalizing an investment in Almaty Airport. The project is expected to expand and modernize the airport and improve customer experience and connectivity, making Almaty a key hub for travel across the wider region. But we also need to build back better with everyone in mind, especially those who've been hit the hardest by the pandemic, small businesses, informal enterprises, and low-income households. In February, we launched a new fast-track program dedicated exclusively to the base of the pyramid, intensifying our efforts to provide more than 400 million to financial service providers. Under this program in Kazakhstan, we provided microfinance organization KMF with a $25 million loan to further enable it to support its 217,000 customers. The third recovery needs to be addressed is the financial inequalities within societies, including gender-based discrimination. According to the United Nations, women will lose as much as 25 years of development progress because of the pandemic. To help them gain back the ground they have lost, we are continuing to work with financial institutions to provide capital to female entrepreneurs. For example, in Central Asia, we are helping the Uzbek DARF Bank expand its financing for women-owned businesses across the country. Finally, considering environmental and social and corporate governance factors is key to resilient recovery. Nearly 90% of our clients believe our ESG support is key to helping them reach their long-term business goals, improve their relations with their stakeholders and local communities, and boost their brand value and recognition. We work with our clients to understand and manage ESG risks they face, and we partner with industry and other stakeholders to find innovative solutions that open up opportunities for economic, socially, and environmentally sustainable private investment. I think it's safe to say that IFC has become the benchmark for investment community when it comes to sustainability issues. A strong ESG foundation will better equip us to recover from the current crisis and weather future ones. Let me close by zooming in on Kazakhstan. While the pace of economic recovery remains dependent on the situation across pandemic, advancing structural reforms while tackling the pandemic will be essential for a strong, sustainable, and inclusive economic recovery. This will also enable the private sector participation. I see four priority areas for reform in this context. The first is to diversify the economic base by improving competitiveness of the non-oil and gas sectors, including through reforms in the financial sector and investment policies. IFC stands ready to help the government of Kazakhstan with implementing its comprehensive program to expand the role of the private sector, diversify sources of growth, and achieve sustainable and long-term growth. As I mentioned, we've been working with leading financial microfinance organizations like KMF and Anua Credit to boost lending to micro and small enterprises, including women entrepreneurs, and borrowers in the remote border areas of Kazakhstan. The second is to limit the role of state-owned enterprises, enhance competition, and create a more level playing field for the private sector. In that regard, we are very pleased to see the government of Kazakhstan supporting greater private sector participation through public-private partnerships, PPPs, and we're helping the government implement PPPs in healthcare and renewable energy. The third priority is to improve the sustainability by promoting energy efficiency. IFC has been working with the government to help develop reforms that improve access to finance for an upgrade in infrastructure, including improved transport, more efficient energy and district heating systems, and better waste management in cities. Finally, it is crucial for the government's efforts to establish a dynamic and competitive digital economy continues. Since 2019, IFC has been working with the Mayor's Office of the City of Almaty to help the municipality ramp up its investments in critical infrastructure, including through the use of cutting-edge technologies. With the right design and implementation, these reforms can have the potential to mitigate some of the adverse impacts of the pandemic, and together with the successful rollout of vaccines, can boost confidence and offer an impetus to economic recovery across the country. Thank you, Jacob.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Ms. Georgina Baker, for these enlightening remarks. And we are now moving to a global financial institution, to Dr. Liu T, who is, of course, very important executive vice president at the Shanghai Stock Exchange. Maybe you can tell us what is the role that capital markets institutions can provide in achieving these objectives. Please, the floor is yours. Dr. Liu.
Dear guests, dear ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. I'm very happy to participate in our today's session of Astana Finance Days. It's a pity that I cannot meet with you personally because of the pandemic. It's not just the obstacle for personal communication, but it negatively impacted on the development of the economy of the whole region. That is why the topic of our today's forum, restoring growth is very important. In China, we control the restoration of the growth of the economy and our daily life. That is the priority for us. For our stock exchange, it's very important to play a very important role in the restoration of the production and to help to the market of capital. Last year, we organized the issuing of bonds in order to prevent the pandemic in the amount of more than $1 billion USD. And we released the companies from the interest rates are payments. If we analyze the situation in long-term perspectives, how the stock exchange can effectively help the development of the region, I would like to share with my thoughts here. First of all, it's very important to work on the construction and developing new markets to use the functions of the stock exchange. For example, let's take our Shanghai Stock Exchange. Over last several years, in May 2021, the capitalization of our shares amounted 7.63 billion USD, and the volume of depositarium amounting 2.19 trillion USD. In 2020, the capital that was attracted via bonds and share amounted more than 80 million the USD. As for investments of funds market, share based on one stock that combines all sectors in the world, focuses on the development and innovations. And currently, we take one of the advanced positions on the volume of trades in the transitioning, in the transition, whether quality development, we work together with the developing sectors, including ETF Star 50, ETF for new technologies, and so on. And recent time, and all these products are in first top three ETF in the world. And all these instruments are not effective instruments for risk management, but in order to effectively price. And that is why we need to cover the demands in all stages of the development. First of all, in order to issue shares in 2019, the Shanghai Stock Exchange created a stock market in order to register the shares, and many companies are the parts of this market. There are about $60 billion. USD STAR market provided a new ways for financing for each amount of companies that provides the support for economic transition and modernization of industry. The second, as for innovations in products. Last week, we seen the listing of first five
RIIT,
and we prioritize the locations with low developed industries. And we use the securitization of assets in order to direct invests from the capital markets in order to release the debt burden, in order to improve the capital market share in real sectors of the economy. The third, in order to support the strategies, the Shanghai Stock Exchange last year issued bonds on Belt One Road, 24 bonds in amount of 26.8 billion yuan, or 4.2 billion USD was issued, and also Shanghai Stock Exchange introduced the innovators' methods, for example, the carbon effectiveness or carbon neutrality bonds. And last year, about 23 green companies were listed for IPO on the market of bonds, reached about 40 billion USD. And the last, it's very important to strengthen the regional and national cooperation. And recent years, strengthening on development, the Shanghai Stock Exchange strengthened on cooperation with different stock exchanges in Asia and in other countries of the world. In 2014, they launched a stock connector with Shanghai and Hong Kong. And in the June 2021, the volume of a stock connect amounted about 3.4 billion USD. It was the volume of trades. And now four companies registered in Shanghai Stock Exchange, and they are attracted to also London Stock Exchange in the amount of 2.6 billion USD. And as for interaction with the products, Chinese and Japanese technologies created new types of interaction. We cooperate with a South Korea Stock Exchange, and currently we also know that in 2018, they launched Astana International Exchange together with AIFC, with the organizers of this forum. And within 3 years, they achieved specific progress. And we will continue our cooperation with AIFC and AX. And in China, we say that for good friends, there are not boundaries. In the future, we will continue to strengthen the mechanisms of cooperation with a stock exchange industry in order to strengthen the cooperation in the capital market in order to put all the efforts to develop our markets. I wish you all success. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Liu T. And we are moving now to the International Monetary Fund. And our good friend, Jia Tazul, will, I hope, tell us a little bit about the global role. After all, in this current challenges, international cooperation through financial institutions become more and more important. I leave it to you to decide to tell us what are the key issues. My dear friend, Gia, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Jacob. Good morning, good afternoon, everyone. And also I would like to thank AIFC for hosting us today, and congratulations for keeping your events despite all the challenges that we are going through. I think we are all converging on the importance of the moment. And I would like to say that I see two moments in one. The first one is the transition to recovery and still overcoming the pandemic. And the second one is how to succeed the big transformation that will lead to a sustainable and inclusive growth. And those are two elements that, in fact, are interrelated. The first one is the recovery. If we go back a year ago, this crisis was, in fact, double whammy crisis affected the economy because of COVID, but also the shock at the oil and energy side, which is also an important dimension in the region. What we saw a fast response from authorities with the fiscal stimulus that was above what we saw in other emerging economies. They put at use of the monetary policy in order to cushion and protect the economy from external shock and complemented by macro fiscal measures. Those fiscal, monetary, and financial measures helped, in fact, to limit the drop in economy and accelerate the recovery. And I would say that we saw also another dimension, which is the external factors that improved dramatically over the course of the last year. If you recall, in the beginning of the crisis, we were in a situation where oil price had reached $20 to $22 a barrel, which affected heavily many economies in the region. But gradually, we saw a rapid recovery in oil price. Now we are at $75 a barrel. We saw also a very strong resilience of remittances, which a lifeline to many countries in the region. In addition, a return in capital flows, both private capital flows and official capital flows. For example, we as the fund, we have provided the region of Central Asia and Middle East with $17 billion, the largest increase in financing in 1 year. We provided financing to Uzbekistan, Kyrgyz Republic, Georgia, Armenia, and other countries in the region. This return in capital flows, improvement in the global financial conditions, helped recover or accelerate the recovery. Where do we are today? We are today in a situation where after a negative growth of 1.9% in the region last year, we expect growth to be at 3.4, 3.5 this year. So a recovery that started with the last quarter last year. This recovery will remain in a range of 3.5 to 4%. This is good, but it's not enough because you need at least 7 years to return to the trends that you had prior to 2019 in terms of growth trend. To cover the gap between average development indicators with the emerging European economies, we need 20 years. Therefore, and this is where I would say the real issue is going forward. In addition to that, this recovery is casted with uncertainties. The first one is the virus itself. We are still in a battle where we have two groups of countries. We have early inoculators who have started the process of vaccinating and others who are lagging behind. And our analysis is showing that in the region, you could lose almost 0.5% of growth if you are a late inoculator. But also there are other uncertainties. The first is global financial conditions. We all expect that they will tighten in 2022-2023, and a risk of premature withdrawal of fiscal stimulus that could also have a side effect on those economies. Therefore, this is where the two transformations are coming together. Transition to recovery and succeed the big transformation that will allow to sustain the recovery. See this equivalent to what we saw after the collapse in the Soviet Union. In fact, it has started in 2015 when we saw certain transformation in monetary, financial, and economic management that has led to withstand the shock that we saw in 2015, 2016, and start the recovery. But I think now the priority is how to A, benefit from the global recovery, two, how to assess what are the transformation that the region need to focus on. And I think we are all agreeing on what needs to be done. I think the most important element is on the how. And for that, there are two pillars. The first one is back to basics, protect the fundamentals, foster the recovery for countries who have fiscal space to maintain it, for those who have less fiscal space to reorganize both their monetary and financial support, but to keep it for some time. Safeguarding macro financial stability is important because although debt is low, but it has increased by 7% last year. And the dependence on financial markets is growing. I'm very much encouraged by the fact that certain countries like Kazakhstan are developing and deepening their financial market. This is an important step that could serve Kazakhstan and also countries in the region. But this is an issue to focus on. In addition to that, I would say the grand transformation, I will repeat what has been said earlier. There are three. One is where growth is going to come from. And here, technology, as we saw during the last year, was one of the silver lining, climate transformation, but also rethinking global integration from corridor to platforms. This region has rediscovered itself. And I'm very pleased to witness that over the last at least 3-4 years, the opening of Uzbekistan brought additional trade in the region and additional growth. And there is now a new identity that is emerging, a new market that could not only serve as platform in the global value chain, but also as a market itself. We did a study recently that showed that you could increase growth by almost 1.5% by implementing some of the measures that we all know are useful. One, for example, accelerate the linkages to the global value chain. We're bringing between 0.5 to 1%. Second is improving business environment and in particular, financial inclusion, and so on and so forth. Therefore, the driver for growth are going to be in need for enablers. And enablers are A, new infrastructure in technology. We saw that there is a big differentiator in the last year between those who have access to technology and those who did not have access to technology, especially youth and women were very much on the sideline because of lack of access to technology. Develop common infrastructure in the region, it's going to be very important. Education and scientific collaboration. I always take the example. Europe has a very successful project, which is Airbus, that at least 5 countries are involved in it. Therefore, we need to move from a cooperation that is done at state level to cooperation around project. Last but not the least, there is this third dimension that has emerged, confidence, trust. And confidence to be restored requires reforming institutions. And here I see some low-hanging fruits like transforming and reforming SOEs. We are about to release a study that we did with EBRD on reforming SOEs that will show that there is huge potential of improving growth and improving competitiveness by finishing a business that has started. The second dimension to restore trust is social. Social is one of the key dimensions that have emerged with the crisis as an important pillar. Informality is still very high in the region, and this informality is limiting the capacity to provide additional support to the private sector. Financial inclusion would require to address the issue of informality, would also require to accelerate the digital transformation. And here, each country cannot do it alone. They need to work together. Last but not the least, inclusion is also very important. Role of women and youth. We released a study recently on social inclusion that showed that tremendous effort and improvement over the last 2 decades since early 1990s, but still we are declining over the last few years. And this is why we saw some issues in terms of social pressure or social unrest. Therefore, these three pillars would be a kind of an agenda that the region can embrace. I am very much encouraged to see the key leaders in the region working together now more and more in order to create a new space that will, instead of having a lot land region, is to have a region that become a crossroad among different big economic players. Europe, with the $750 billion of investment in transformation, could benefit the region. The sovereign wealth funds in the region and also in MENA, who are currently dedicating resources to invest in those transformative sectors. And of course, the big pillars of growth, China and Russia. Therefore, I see a moment that requires to rethink the strategy. And also I'm happy to see that both Kazakhstan has already started charting the course not only for the recovery, but for the next 10 years, and also other countries chipping in. Uzbekistan, I see Georgia and others also moving in this direction. Therefore, it's an important moment, very exciting, but also still very challenging.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Jihad, for these optimistic views and challenging views. And we are now turning to Dr. Umar Zakov from Uzbekistan. And let us come back indeed, therefore, to Central Asia. We have heard ideas and assessments of growth opportunities from different international experts. Dr. Umar Zakov, could you please share your views as a person responsible for investments in one of the two key Central Asian countries? And moreover, it would be appreciated if you could indicate how Kazakhstan and Uzbekistan could work together to restore or reinvent growth in their countries and the whole of Central Asia. And this would be especially appropriate as we have with us Sir Suma, who is the advisor to both the presidents of Kazakhstan and Uzbekistan. So let's get from here the joint recipe for rejuvenation and growth. Mr. Minister, Mr. Deputy Prime Minister, the floor is yours.
Many thanks, dear Dr. Frankel. Thank you very much. It gives me a special pleasure today to participate in this session. I've been carefully listening to the speeches of our colleagues who presented their views before me. And I have to say that I want to thank everybody for very valuable opinions and proposals. Now, as you said, Dr. Frankel, if we go back to the region and discuss the issues of restoring of a sustainable growth here, I'd like, first of all, to tell you that the pandemic, which has started last year, actually opened our eyes on many, many important aspects and issues, especially in Uzbekistan and, I believe, in other countries of Central Asia as well. We discovered or realized a lot of weaknesses, which we never paid attention before. But at the same time, we also explored or discovered new opportunities, which were actually always around, but we also didn't pay attention to them. And yes, indeed, in Uzbekistan, we still managed to demonstrate an economic growth last year. And this was among very few countries in the world. But at the same time, this growth was, of course, far below our initial expectations and plans. However, I have to say that all those weaknesses or weakness points which we discovered, they now need to be addressed, and we need to focus on them in order to provide a continued and sustainable growth. I would say that major weakness point which we in Uzbekistan really felt, especially during first several months of pandemic or lockdown in the world, is the geographical location, lack of diversity in transport communication, for, of course, primarily for transportation of the commodities. And another important conclusion which we made last year was that we should continue in Uzbekistan our movement along the path of wide-scale reform agenda. And even despite the challenges caused by pandemic last year, I think one of our major achievements in Uzbekistan was that we managed to continue our reform agenda, although we had to delay or postpone some of the reforms, but still we tried to our best to continue. And of course, it took a lot of efforts, and it was, frankly speaking, enormously challenging for us. But I think that this is the major achievement, because we believe that reforms took irreversible nature, and now we need to accelerate. And final conclusion which we did, but this is probably last but not least, as we usually say, is that we should now look at the prospects of our growth from regional point of view. Of course, by regional, I mean Central Asia. We again and again discussed about internally here in the government of Uzbekistan about the huge untapped potential for cooperation between Central Asian countries. We have clearly realized last year that we should think, we should plan, we should work regionally rather than nationally. And if we want to survive in the post-COVID world, in the post-COVID economic reality, then we should, of course, stop so-called competition or stop competing with each other, because our basically our economies, they don't compete, but they rather complement each other. Unfortunately, a lot of our colleagues in many countries around our region, they don't understand this clear truth. Unfortunately, even in Uzbekistan, we have a lot of people who don't really understand that so far. I can give you one example. Recently, a couple of weeks ago, we actually visited Tajikistan with the official visit. When I say we, I mean a governmental delegation headed by the president of the country, of Uzbekistan. So what we did, we basically, before that, we tried to sit and analyze all the strengths and weaknesses of our economies, Uzbekistan and Tajikistan. So after that, we worked out, we worked hard, frankly speaking, but we managed to work out and then present our proposals for concrete projects to business communities of two countries, where they can actually complement each other, where we can use the potential of two countries, potential for joining forces and for joint growth. And after that, we organized a special event, business forum, and we tried to do it in the least developed region of that, one of the least developed regions of Tajikistan, which is Hatlon province. And the result was actually really surprising, because we managed to put business circles of two countries together. And as a result, we have now more than 200 concrete projects worth $700 million. And all of them are about joining forces for creation of value chains, for manufacturing of export-oriented goods, which would, first of all, of course, satisfy the demand in local markets and then also be exported to markets of third countries. I also want to emphasize that all these projects were mainly or have already started to be implemented mainly by small and medium enterprises of two countries. Another good example of how we could actually join our forces is a joint investment fund, which we created with Kyrgyzstan. And only today, we already have a pipeline of projects worth $677 million. And I'm sure that we will start financing quite soon. Also, we've established a joint investment company in Tajikistan. It's basically more than 90% the capital will be financed by Uzbekistan for more than 90%. But this is not something that matters. What matters really is that it will focus on the projects of a type I've already described. I think that another very important point for us in Central Asia is that we should jointly work on improvement and enhancement of infrastructure and connectivity issues. By the way, as you probably are aware, we are planning to hold a special international conference on connectivity issues on 15th, 16th July. And I think that these kind of events, these kind of platforms, where we could discuss all very important issues, can be shown as a good example of how we should proceed. Another very important point in our view is that we should also try to coordinate our efforts for which we actually put to create or improve the investment climate, business climate, to promote investment climate in our countries. We should not be shy, simply speaking, to learn from each other. Because recently what I did in my team here in Uzbekistan, we tried to basically analyze investment climate in two countries, Uzbekistan and Kazakhstan. So there is much to learn from each other. And we've already started doing our homework. And I believe that if we all join our forces, if we have a lot of discussion platforms, if we put our expert community together, then we could also create more coordination when it comes to creation of a unified or single investment space in Central Asia. Again, I want to one more time emphasize that we should stop our, sorry for my wording, but we should stop our paranoia about, competing each other or benefiting from each other, you know, for the cost of other side, because truly we can only provide sustainable, we can only provide continued growth, economic growth in our countries by joining our forces. So basically, I don't want to speak too much. So my message today is that we should stop competing with each other because we're not competitors. We should join our forces, and all of us, governments, private sector representatives, NGOs, expert communities, we all should use existing potential for the benefit of our people. We should also try to concentrate on concrete issues, on particular initiatives and projects, you know, without only speaking about some general, very interesting and nice ideas or slogans about our common past and common future. But we should work rather than speak, and we should concentrate on specific projects. And we have actually very good examples of joint projects which could serve for the benefit of not only, for example, Uzbekistan and Kazakhstan, but the whole region. And also, I think that, frankly speaking, we have lost a lot of time and chances before. We should take current situation seriously, and especially if we take into account new challenges which we now face in Central Asia, including, of course, security risks in view of latest developments in Afghanistan and some other risks and some other challenges. It gives me special pleasure to actually speak about the plan to gather all leaders of all five Central Asian countries in August this year. This will be for the third time in our modern history in last 3 years. And we believe that this will be a clear demonstration of our commitment to move in the right direction. And I want to use this opportunity to thank actually all our participants. I want to thank our partners from MDBs, from IFC, from IMF, financial institutions like Astana Financial Center or Shanghai Stock Exchange. And of course, I want to express my gratitude to my dearest Suma, who is actually a symbol of our future joint coordinated work in Central Asia. Because Mr. Frankel, you've mentioned that Uzbekistan and Kazakhstan are two key Central Asian countries. I think that with due respect to you, to your words, that in Central Asia, we have five key countries, and all of them have their own place and have to play their own role when it comes to our sustainable growth for more than 65 million people living in this region. So thank you very much. And I will be more than happy to host all of you in Uzbekistan someday.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Minister, Deputy Prime Minister, for these dynamic words and of course, the emphasis on the important role of international cooperation among partners, and especially emphasizing the Kazakhstan-Uzbekistan linkage, and of course with the other five key countries. I would like to turn now to Governor Kairat Kelimbetov. Now that we have heard about the national strategies, about financial sector developments, about international cooperation, this leads us to reforms in Kazakhstan and the particular role of the Astana International Financial Center, which spearheads the reforms and contributes to sustainable growth in Kazakhstan and, in fact, in the whole region. Could you please, dear Kairat, reflect on what the other speakers have brought to the panel and share your own views on the restoration of and rejuvenation of growth? Thank you. Please, Kairat, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Also, I would like to express my gratitude to all the participants who today discuss all these opportunities for growth. I agree with the definition that it should be sustainable and inclusive growth. And I think in these terms, like the two tiers which have been mentioned by Jihad Azur is like reforms, recent reforms and what should be done in the future from one side, and from the other side, what is our response to pandemic influence. As you remember, Kazakhstan started to become, create a system which can be immune from the shocks, external shocks and volatilities of commodities prices since 2008. So 2008 was a global financial crisis influence to our banking sector. 2014 and 15, it was a crisis of the prices for oil. And since those time, we tried to build the counter-cyclical budget policy. We started to strengthening our national fund, like a sovereign wealth fund, which can be cushioned for the difficult, for the rainy days from one side. And from the other side, we moved to the inflation targeting regime, which can up the system, which where we have a floated exchange rate, which can help absorb any kind of the shocks. But at the same time, definitely we should build something which is focusing on building new institutions. And AFC become one of the such institutions. So from one side is a part of the legal reforms towards the rule of law. From the other side is based on common law jurisdiction. From the other side is part of the economic reform, like privatization, diversification of the economy, strengthening the capital markets platform. So I think in these terms, we succeed enough in these few years. But now is a new crisis is coming. So as Mr. Azur mentioned, there was different response. I think the Kazakh response was very much solid. We spent 9% of GDP in order to redistribute the money of the national fund on the three stages, which we call flatten the curve, epidemiological response, fighting the crisis, especially the helping the SME community, and the building the future. And here is a very much common for the countries in the region, including Kazakhstan and Uzbekistan and Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, Turkmenistan as well. So how we should change the current economic policy? What should be our relevant response to the all these upcoming trends, which is in parallel are coming? The pandemic just accelerate this influence, clock speed is accelerating in terms of the changes of fourth industrial revolution, ending of the super cycle for commodities, new challenge on climate change. So all of this stuff is very much important. So that's why we start to think about how to design reforms. And President Tokayev creates a special council on reforms, Supreme Council on reforms. And by the way, Sir Suma Chakrabarty is a deputy chair over there. And I think it's a great synergy now, what's going on now in Kazakhstan and, for example, in Uzbekistan. So we do have this process of reforms. I think that is always needed to reform the economies from one side, and there is no any competition, I think, in this term. So because we are really, like Deputy Prime Minister Sardor Umurzakov mentioned, so we are more complementary economically to each other rather than we are competing. And I absolutely agree with the point of the regional connectivity. So I think that any investor who wants to invest any countries in the region wants to have in mind also the additional market. And currently we are 55 million people. According to BCG, we would be the 100 million people in 20 years. So it's a common market which we have to build with regional identity, and we have to strengthen the physical connectivity, digital connectivity between ourselves. And by the way, the recent experience how the Kazakhstan and Uzbekistan are talking to each other, the regular meetings of the presidents, regular meetings of the governments, prime ministers are calling each other each week. So this is absolute confidence and trust. And we do believe that that's only going to be strengthened. And my response also to the proposal which has been done by our colleagues is, yes, we're working on diversification. And here is the investment to human capital, healthcare system, strengthening healthcare system, education system, and also building this entrepreneurship spirit from one side, and from the other side to investment to infrastructure, let's say diversify from out of the oil and gas sector towards agriculture, digital economy. This is something which we want to focus on. And we are now building the special ammunition, which we call national projects. It will be special government programs which focus on the particular dimension of diversification, including strengthening the financial regulation, strengthening the also the one of the aspects is like relaunching the credit process in the banking community. And here I am echo to the Ms. Georgina Baker, the building the NPLs asset market, which can allow us to bring global investors to help us to resolve these issues, to bring these assets back to the economic turnover. So all of this stuff are very much similar in line with what has been said by our colleagues. And I hope that Sersuma is not only the symbol, but is also would be the key driver of the reforms in our countries and drivers of the building trust between countries in the region of the Central Asia. So because of the lack of the time, let me conclude here by the famous slogan, which I would like to rephrase a little bit, because we are countries with a really vast history, the common history, and now our landlocked region wants to be connected to the rest of the world, wants to be also, we want to bring economic prosperity to the region. And I would like to summarize it in some phrase like, let's make Silk Road great and green again. So this is my proposal to all of us. Thank you again for the panelists. I hope that we do have now kind of stakeholders panel for the building this regional identity, regional connectivity in Central Asia. And we absolutely appreciate for your current status quo, would be appreciated even more to work together with you. And thank you, special thanks to Dr. Sardor Umurzakov, who figured out time in his tight schedule. I hope that we will continue this discussion later on in city of Nur-Sultan or in Tashkent. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Kairat, for your closing remarks. And thank you to all our colleagues. And on behalf of the participants, I would like to thank again the AIFC for this fantastic hospitality. We want to thank Sersuma for making sure that both Uzbekistan and Kazakhstan will thrive into the future. And we want to thank the Deputy Prime Minister for the invitation that we will already accept to make sure that we are going and being in person, enjoying the extraordinary fruits of the reform. Thank you to all our friends, and I invite you to the rest of the program of the Astana Days. Have a very good day. Bye-bye. See you.